Mr. Trudeau.
I am ready, Mrs. Tinker.
All right. All right, we are now going to call our athletic field subcommittee meeting to order. Is anyone here for public comment? No? All right, moving along. Did everyone have an opportunity to review the drafted minutes from our last meeting? Okay, I need a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
All right. Excellent. So on to our new business tonight, which is our feasibility study presentation by Gail. And we have Kathy Herbel and Sean Boyd here to present to us. So I am not going to take up any more time because they have fun stuff. So have at it, guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. I'd just like to tell you what a pleasure it is for us to be here tonight. My name is Kathy Herbel with Gail Associates. I'm the project manager overseeing the feasibility studies for the synthetic turf field evaluation. And Sean Boyd is our project engineer for the project over seeing whatever design and such. Sean's done numerous project designs through construction, just finishing up some at Triton, Brown, and some other local schools this summer. So with that, I'd just like to get started with our agenda for this evening. I'd just like to touch quickly on what we understand our scope to be per our proposal and such, our project goals, what we think you're looking for, and what we try to make as a priority when you are putting in a synthetic turf field. We just want to touch briefly on who Gail is and a little of our experience. I know some of you know us and are familiar with our what we've done in the past, but we'd like to just take a quick opportunity and show you some of what we've done. Then we'd lead right into reviewing the existing conditions of the different fields that we evaluated in the high school and middle school complex, present our proposed concepts for those areas regarding synthetic turf and our estimated costs. We'll review schedule for the project, design, permitting, construction, and also touch some on maintenance and any other questions you might have. Hopefully we can answer those. So to assist the Hopkinton Public Schools to evaluate the feasibility of installing synthetic turf and athletic fields at the middle school, high school complex. We were originally brought on board to do a feasibility study for what we call fields 4 and 5, which we did early this year. I think we finished the report in April. Then we were also asked to continue and evaluate the existing field within the existing track, what it would take possibly to expand the track and to do a larger synthetic field within the new expanded track, and then also to look at field 13, one of the larger soccer fields in off the Loop Road. So all our goals for the project is usually, safety is our first thing, and having well-drained facilities so they're dry so the kids can play on them. We also hit on ideal field geometry. I think we've talked in previous meetings, but there's several recommendations on field dimensions that are required through both the National Foundation of State High School field dimensions as well as the MIAA, and making sure you have things like safety runouts, things like that for the kids. We also looked at some things affiliated with the field, such as your pedestrian access, ADA compliance, gave some thought about parking and different directions you might be coming from. We've also, just kind of reviewed grandstands, athletic lighting, had some preliminary meetings with some of the board members and hit on some of those ideas. Obviously aesthetics, anything we can do to help make the field look more yours, I guess, show your pride and whatever we can do to enrich those facilities. Our relationship to the other fields, how it ties, if it's a good thing or maybe it's not so good. We try to help you along with consensus of, building a consensus among the community and also assisting with community input as we are today. So.
Before moving on to the specific project here at Hopkinton, a little bit more about who we are for those of you who don't know us. We are roughly a 100-person engineering and consulting firm. We have a few different niches. We're a company of niches. We have an aviation division, a building envelope division, roofs and facades. We also have a structural division that supports all of our divisions for any structural need that we have. The group that Kathy and I are part of is the Athletic and Civil Engineering Division. We both went to school. Our background is in engineering, and to be able to wake up and do sports every day is a win-win, as I was mentioning to some of these guys here before. We have regional offices throughout Florida, Baltimore, Connecticut, New Hampshire. We're up and down the East Coast. And we are one of our most important pieces that we like to, that we're proud of, is we have roughly a 95% repeat business. We're on our fourth assignment at Brown University now, and I'll show you a picture for that. Those are projects that, that's what we like to work towards during our projects with you. We want to come back and help you through the next project. So anything we can do to answer questions or assist along the way, we're here to do that. Some of our representative projects, a few of them a local that you may know, is Medway High School. We completed a couple years ago inside their existing track, new synthetic turf, new combination softball, baseball. They use it for baseball practice, Little League, and then a main practice football field as well. This was actually a raw land piece of site that we developed into a new synthetic turf field with parking associated with it. A Triton Regional High School, which is in Byfield, Mass., Newbury, Mass., which we just finished up. And the reason why we wanted to show you this today is because in one of the options that we'll show later on, the existing wall, or the proposed, the new wall along the whole entire backside, they're trying to strive something that you guys are possibly looking at, is expanding the width of the track to accommodate a more ideal playing width inside of the track oval. They accomplished that by pushing out into the marsh here and by building a 6-foot on average, 6-foot wall. Norwell High School did the same exact thing. They expanded their footprint. We're proud, exceptionally proud of this one. We won the 2015 American Sports Builders Outstanding Facility of the Year Award. So we like to show that one off. But we also designed a combination field, something on field 4 and 5, I believe, that is comparable, to where there's a softball bump out in the corner, and we're able to utilize the field for soccer in the opposite direction. So all things we can reference back as we're going through your options to look at realistic images and pictures of what's out there. And last, to touch on baseball and softball for possibly fields 4 and 5, we're just finishing up our, like I said, fourth assignment at Brown for their new baseball and softball field projects. All the amenities associated with it, dugouts and foul poles and batting tunnels, that we can bring our experience to Hopkinton about how those all work within the project and how the best way to incorporate those. And then getting back to...
Keep playing. Back to our study. So just want to touch briefly on existing conditions. As I said, we were asked to study synthetic turf at both fields 4 or 5, which is your existing baseball field with the softball field in the area basically running this area right in here. We were also asked to look inside the existing track area for synthetic turf, as well as possibly expanding this, which I'll get into a little more detail. And then coming right down around the loop road, we have field 13, which is quite a large multi-purpose field that you have now that I know is used a lot for soccer, but, and I know there is a small softball field there as well, and it's my understanding it's not used very much, but that's what we, those. That's just basically, just to give you a sense of, you know, the three fields we're talking about. Next slide. One of the things we talk about, and this isn't, you know, 100% representative, but we call it existing conditions, but we also, you know, focus on environmental constraints, things that are going to impact your project schedule and such. We know at field 4 or 5, a portion of that field is within a wetland, the buffer zone, the 100-foot buffer zone, so chances are we're going to need, you know, a notice of intent through the Conservation Commission. So those are just things to, you know, be in our consideration and part of, you know, getting the project done. Field 13 has a similar circumstance. Let me just point. Here's, this is the field 4 and 5 in here. This little block, this is off from the state MassGIS. There's actually actual mapping when this field was done that has wetlands more in this area, which shows up more in the existing conditions plan. Right now, as far as the track and field goes, we're not aware of wetlands and such in that area or a buffer zone, but there could be some wet over here, and obviously if that were to go ahead, those are things that we would, you know, evaluate in more detail, you know, delineate wetlands and such and get into permitting. And then field 13, you have this lot, this is field 13. We've got this wetland system coming through that, again, I think we probably would be in the 100-foot buffer zone, and permitting could be an issue. I'd just also like to note that, as far as we know, and based on state record, there's no, like, endangered species or anything in this area to be concerned of, or public wells, things along those lines.
Yeah, so. Phase one of any project is really doing an investigation of the existing conditions. What we're using today are existing maps and existing record documents in MassGIS. You know, online Google Earth mapping is fantastic these days with contours and what you're able to get, but until we actually go on site and survey the baseball and softball fields and really locate those wetlands, everything we're talking about today is not 100%.
I'm going to just start briefly and talk about the existing conditions at your existing track and field that sits behind the middle school. The existing track is considered as being fairly narrow. The radius, when we talk just a few parts, obviously this part's considered your radius, your straightaways. This piece right here, they sit called the D area, just looks like a D and such, just whatever. So, but like we said, the radius on the existing track is at a little over 104 feet. So it's fairly narrow, which was common for the time it was built. But we find that now today, with a lot of the sports, especially like women's lacrosse and such, it can be restricting to having those type of fields. But currently now you have a 6-lane track all the way around. No, your straightaway is 6 lanes, the ovals are 6 lanes. You have obviously your home bleachers, which seat about 800 people, and your visitor bleachers that sits about 300 people. The track was resurfaced back in 2012. The existing base to that track was not done at that time, so the base of the track is pushing 98. So the base is starting to reach its end of its useful life, and you know, is going to probably be required to be redone a bit, you know, shortly. But
you're usually getting roughly 20 to 25 years out of pavement before you're going to start seeing structural issues with the base mat.
One of the other things I just want to point out on this site, just because we're going to get into constraints a little bit, is the site as you come, you know, coming out the back of the middle school. You know, it drops off and you have this baseball field, and there's some multi-purpose field here. It's kind of flat. Then you have the slope that your bleachers are sitting on, and then you're flat again, and then there's a slope here about 10 to 15 feet on this side, on the back of this, at the back of the track. They even had built a retaining wall to build a flat area to put in the visitors' bleachers on this side. So it's kind of a tiered effect. So obviously that slope and the impacts of what you do here could impact this direction, but also could impact your fields and things that are sitting in this direction. Next slide. Just quickly touching on field 4 and 5, it's the existing baseball field, as we said, and with the small softball field. These are just some pictures, and just so you can get a sense, and here's that slope off the back of the track, football field, and that sits up in that area. I just want to touch on base. Also adjacent to this baseball field, it kind of overlaps with a multi-purpose like soccer field. They, at this time, it's painted to like 325 feet by about 205, so it's a fairly good size soccer field down there. As far as I'm just going to point to the existing conditions plan a little bit more because I can see it better, but as far as access to this field, handicap ADA access, there is a parking lot across from the baseball field in this area, and there are handicap spots. Unfortunately, there's no real access. Once you cross the road, there's no real handicap access up to that field. They do, the official, I think, handicap access is coming down this road. There, you know, this is paved quite a ways that people could drive down, and then this is level through here, but it's not what we feel is adequate access, and there are a few handicapped spots up here as well. And the same would hold true for your track and field too. Access is limited. Your parking for either of these fields, obviously this is limited down here. We all know that for most of these fields, you know, especially for football, you're parking up by the middle school, by the water tank, and, you know, in front of the high school and wherever else you can find a spot on a Friday night. So I just touch base on that. This field is irrigated. It does have two kind of main drains that run through it that go out to the wetland areas, and there does tend to be a wet spot just below this retaining wall area that tends to be an issue during soccer games and such. Next slide. I just touched quickly on field 13 existing conditions. It's a large multi-purpose field. Pretty much can get just about any size soccer field you want on there. It's in pretty good shape. It does have drainage and irrigation. ADA access, again, field 13 down here, I think we all know this is the Hopkins School. You've got that, you know, smaller parking lot down by field 13. Limited parking, otherwise you're hoofing it down here or up in here, not very accessible, but also this, the access into the field, it's not really handicap access. It's definitely gonna need some improvement and such. So just wanna mention that in regards to those fields. Next slide. All right, so the first concept that we approached was what we're calling option one, which is looking to see what synthetic turf field fields we can get within your existing track. We've looked at the standards as regards to field dimensions, and what we have shown here is kind of your major sport groups and the dimensions that we were able to get within the existing track. Keep in mind that these dimensions all meet the minimum criteria, but soccer and also women's lacrosse are falling short of the recommended widths. And also, a lot of these do not really have adequate runouts. So, you know, if the kids get off the field, they're hitting the track pretty quick. And obviously, that can be dangerous. A lot of schools do it. We've done many tracks where schools just get a synthetic turf, put it in our track. But, you know.
Typically, you shorten the length a little bit so your corner kick areas aren't right up against the asphalt. But the MIA recognizes that, you know, a 104.43 radius was standard track size 30, 40 years ago. It's actually 100 meters in the straightaway, 100 meters on each oval, so it's equal quadrant track. They recognize that it's built for American football, 360 foot length, 160 feet wide. So the minimum dimensions for all the sports, football, soccer, and lacrosse, fit within those dimensions, within those thresholds. But certainly we've gotten feedback from a lot of soccer folks and a lot of women's lacrosse folks that they don't want to be playing at that narrow. They want to expand the width and make sure that they can get a full-size field to support their program.
So we put together a feasibility study. We have more detailed cost breakdown, but the main chunks are associated with, obviously, the synthetic turf installation, the improvements to the drainage, the under-drainage under the field, and some safety netting so that you can be doing things in the D areas and such, why there might be practices and things like that going on the field. And this is for this synthetic turf field, you know, within your existing track, you know, we're looking at an estimate of about $1.5 million.
Yeah.
Can you help orient me on the lines that are around it? Because it looks like, and I can't, I don't
there's
know if
there's some
right
of their dimensions.
Some
yeah.
On to
oh,
the track,
you know what? This
like.
Might help. You want Sean or?
Yeah, if you could pull that one up, yeah, show
yeah. Show this a little closer, but basically we have we've shown what you see is the different colors. Blue is field hockey. Black is lacrosse. We've got women's lacrosse. We've got soccer is the yellow, the outside. And what we've done is, and it's, you know, we're trying to show, you know, some of the dimensions and
oh,
such.
Oh, so those are just measure markers.
These
they're
are
not
just
field,
measured.
They're
yeah,
not
what,
fields,
you're looking,
just show
what you're looking
okay.
at is, see this blue out here, that's your women's lacrosse, and you can obviously see your
so it
right,
sort of
right
creeps
in track.
Into it, right, yeah. Okay.
And
that's the,
and
the largest surface that you have. So the reds are just,
those are
just measurements.
Are,
okay.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
So. Yeah, one of the biggest options you have with this layout is what do you do with the D areas? You know, we see Marciano Stadium, for example, they turfed one entire D area. So now you have to find a place for your long jump, triple jump, which I think was out here before. So The other option is you pave and surface, track surface, both D areas. It gives you more flexibility for your field events. You get your high jump events, pole vault. The third option, which is my least favorite, is leave them natural grass turf. That creates, in my opinion, a maintenance item where you've got to bring your lawnmowers over across the track, and now you're cutting grass next to a new synthetic turf field. But there are three options. All of them have differences in cost. The most cost-effective is leaving grass, more maintenance, then you go track surfacing for both the areas, and then adding turf to one D area would certainly be the most costly. It adds an extra space, though, for warm-ups and practice as well.
The second option that we looked at, we talked about, is expanding your track to give you a more optimum field space within. Again, we've provided the table of what dimensions we've given for which sports. Even though we are expanding and you have some room, this is kind of where you're kind of confined. We help your existing grandstand in this area. We did give you 8 lanes on the straightaway. We find that a lot of high schools are going to that for the purpose of speeding up track meets and such. You can have more kids running the events and such, so a lot of them for the, you know, your sprinting events on the straightaway, they've gone to the 8 lane. We've put the field in. We've now been able to put in a 115-foot radius. And I guess I just want to clarify the other restriction we had. We talked about that slope on the far side dropping down to these fields. In an effort not to impact these two existing fields, we're proposing a retaining wall, basically running along the edge here, basically to make up the grade difference. This was the bottom of the slope before. Now we'd be putting in a retaining wall. Everything kind of pushes this direction. We've kind of redone the grandstands, made them kind of long and thin, so that, again, just to pick up that space. The softball field here, the bottom of the slope sits here, so theoretically we didn't really impact that field. I think Al had gone out and measured for us 187 feet. Ideal for softball is 200. So it's a little short, but there was slope here anyway, so, you know, and I believe a lot of the women's, the girls' softball is played up on the far corner from here as well. So I know this is used quite a bit by little leagues and things like that. And then obviously trying to maintain and making sure we don't take away this nice large field you have down here as well. So like I said, so we basically have a proposed, you know, average 10-foot retaining wall running through this area, new bleacher area, like I said, the 8-lane track in this area, and we're able, now your distance, instead of being 200 plus minus 208 feet wide, we're now up to 230, giving us that extra area for mostly, like I said, to be able to get into that recommended dimensions for soccer and women's lacrosse. So under this scenario, you know, we've included, obviously, the synthetic turf field. We have a brand new urethane running track. You basically have to blow up the old track, so obviously the costs are going to go up. But as we said earlier, the existing base to your track is approaching its life, so, you know, it might be a cost that was coming anyway. It obviously, you have improved drainage. We've got some safety netting for multiple use. We put in some price to adjust your fencing, you know, around the facility. The retaining wall that we talked about, we've assumed a kind of a small block retaining wall. We actually have been talking with some vendors and trying to get a good number for that retaining wall. Bleacher relocation or a new bleacher install, which I'm going to touch on in a minute. And then athletic lighting relocation. It would be existing lights kind of sat here and here, and obviously they'd have to be moved with that, in that scenario. The only other thing we want to mention in regards to restrooms and bleachers, if you put in new bleachers, permanent bleachers, the new plumbing code requires you to have a restrooms,
yeah,
and many fixtures under the, according to the plumbing code. You can get a variance to cut that in half, but it's just we did not include a price for the new restroom. You could always go, if you go with portable bleachers where the visitors' bleachers were, it doesn't kick in. So, you know, there's a little bit of options there, but just to let you know, that could be another cost down the road.
Yeah, to give you guys a sense of realistic past projects, Triton, again, was a very similar project to this where they had an existing footprint, they wanted to blow it up. They included a retaining wall, not quite as big here. That was bid earlier this year, and the lump sum bid for the track and field portion of that work, including a new home bleachers, was 2.9, rounded up, 2.9 million. There's a lot, not a lot, there's a little bit more retaining wall, a little bit more earthwork, a little bit more fill that would be needed to bring the site level to support the new track, which is why you see some of the cost being a little bit more. The other thing to note about a new building cost is Triton had the same thing, that the plumbing code is triggered by a permanent fixture, seat count. And in the plumbing code is written for a Gillette Stadium or Fenway Park, and the fixture count for, you know, a 1,200 person bleacher system will get up to 30 fixtures for female, 15 for male. I mean, it's a very excessive amount. So with success, we've had success going to the state plumbing code and they granted a 50% waiver. That building cost, they ended up getting a waiver, so it's 14 female fixtures and 7 male fixtures for their 1,200 person bleacher system. That building with a team room, concessions, a ticket window, was public bid was about $1.1 million for that building. So all in, their total project cost was $4.2 million.
Is that total sinks and toilets, or is that just toilets?
That's just toilets. 14 female fixtures and 7 male fixtures plus the sinks. You know, it's one of the most expensive parts of a building, the construction, is, you know, an open team room with some shelving and benches, certainly less expensive than the fixtures and all the plumbing work that needs to go along with that.
So under this option two, like I said, not, you know, at this point, you know, excluding the restroom building, assuming that you'd use more like a portable bleachers on the visitor side, is in the realm of 3.1 million. Next slide. As I said, we looked at field 4 and 5 as well. This was looking for a very large multi-purpose field. As we've encompassed the baseball as well as softball, soccer and such. This is where that existing field we were talking about, you know, in this area, and making that all turf in working with the school. We've assumed some obviously improved drainage. We did look at that, put in some costs to account for the ADA access up in the, coming from the parking lot across the loop road. Athletic, we assume some athletic lighting, modifying some of the existing lights, maybe perhaps over by the football field and then putting some around. Portable bleachers in a few spots, and in this case, we also were asked to kind of make an assumption for a small storage building down there for equipment and such. With that all included, the cost was $3.4 million. But if you were to take out the lights, the portable bleachers, and your storage building, you're more in the 2.5 range. So
this is a very large space. And if you go in with, say, portable mounds for baseball and all turf for softball, like, you've got such versatility of running soccer and lacrosse this way or this way, running many practices game events on the field as well.
Yeah, it'd be great for the community. I think we had laid out like 5, like 190 by 320 or something fields that we had, you know, several coming across for, you know, little soccer tournaments, things like that for the community.
The disadvantage with this option is you're not set up for games, football games, your stadium football game. Really wants to be played inside the track. You've got your existing lights, you've got your seating. That's what you lose with this option.
And the last option, we were asked to look at the field 13, which is the combination of the soccer multi-purpose and there's the small softball field. They asked for us to see if we could, you know, how big a field we could get in there. We're able to get two fields that one is like 190 by 300 on the far side, and this one over here is 210 by 360, so it's definitely large enough for, you know, lacrosse, the full-size soccer, all of those needing that. Again, we talked about the ADA access, that we put in some costs to account for making some of those improvements. We put assumed some safety netting between the two fields so you don't get, you know, interference from games and such. And in this case, you know, through discussions with the school, we also included some costs for lighting, bringing this option to about $3.3 million. But if you did take the lighting out, you were probably closer to $2.7.
It's all in, like, soft cost, hard cost, permitting?
These assume 15% for contractors, overhead, and profit. 15% just because it's preliminary design, and 7% for soft costs on all of these.
Permitting, though, that includes
the permitting's in the soft costs.
We've assumed standard or typical permitting. Yeah.
All right. Just want to hit kind of on this is kind of our typical schedule, but also could apply to you. We don't know how aggressive, you know, your funding and things like that are moving ahead, but. Obviously, we try to get the design going and get it done in the fall, the summer, fall time frame, because obviously survey, soil testing, there's snow on the ground, things like that, it can be difficult. Depends on the winter, you know, sometimes we work right through. But trying to get the design done, you know, by the end of the year, the schematic design, and then the final design, kind of working parallel with the permitting. Sometimes what we do to save time is, we'll use what we call like a 90% plan for the permitting. They don't need to know necessarily, you know, I don't know, the footing design for the walls for the Conservation Commission, things along those lines. So sometimes we can move those ahead a little bit depending on the permitting, all with the goal to, you know, prepare construction docs by first thing in the year and get them out between the February-March timeframe. The reason we recommend that is there's usually a lot of schools doing the same projects in the summer and tend to get, you know, a better price if you're one of the first ones out there. The later it goes, you know, your bids tend to trickle up. And you also, there's only so many companies, construction firms that do this work. So obviously they're starting to get, their schedules are getting full as well. And so that can impact. So that these are our recommendations, you know, award by April, and you know, as soon as you can turn the field over to the contractor in the spring, you know, they get started.
So. The other thing, an early award also allows them, the contractor, to start their submittal process. One of the longest lead items on the field are bleachers. So if there's a portion of your project that includes bleachers, you want to get that submittal in quick. You want to get the contractor to order that material so it's not delaying your project down the line.
What kind of construction delivery are you thinking? Or is it just going right to the subs, or?
This, yeah, typically this is a Chapter 131, 39M lump sum public works construction. When you start getting into the building portion of it, so Triton, for example, was two separate bids. One was Chapter 149, which was for the building, filed sub bids. The track and field has been to a separate group of contractors for the 139M lump sum bid.
Just going to touch on maintenance a little bit. I think there were some questions regarding, tried to do a comparison, just, you know, your kind of your typical grass field versus synthetic turf. And Sean,
yeah, so these numbers are actually, Triton actually outsourced their maintenance. So they had recent record for us on what their maintenance costs were for their game natural grass field. And at the end of the year, they added it up and it was roughly $32,000 per year. Obviously that varies from community, and depending on whether or not you're doing it in-house or outside. We then took that and over a 28-year span brought the cost associated with that back to net present value, assuming a 3% interest rate. When you factor in the initial cost of a straight rectangular natural grass field at, say, roughly $350,000 plus some additional, you get $32,000 per year for annual maintenance, plus some additional every fourth year or every sixth year. there is a robust where you're sodding down the hash marks of football where the heavy traffic areas are. Your net present value is just over $1 million. In the synthetic turf field option, there is the roughly $850,000 just for the turf portion. If you were to take the topsoil off and install the stone base and synthetic turf, just that portion of the project would be roughly around $850,000.
That's for a standard field, like a football field. That's not like some of the big ones that you
look at. Roughly, depending on if it's permanent lines or painted lines and how you're going to either do your maintenance inside or outsource it, we're seeing on average $1,500 a year for maintenance. That's pretty limited. It's not, that's assuming that the lines are permanently or tufted into the carpet and you're grooming the field and picking up trash. Grooming the field roughly half a dozen times in the fall, half a dozen times in the spring. It varies depending on use. At year 15, you have to replace the carpet, the actual synthetic turf carpet. That's a totally different type of construction than the initial phase of removing topsoil and installing the stone base and drainage. That infrastructure is already there, but you're replacing the actual carpet itself. Nowadays, they're actually able to harvest back the sand and rubber infill and reuse it, which has helped saving costs. But your net present value is 1.14. So you're still, the synthetic turf option is roughly $50,000 more when you bring it back to today's value, given a 28-year life cycle. When you factor this in on a per-use basis, then the synthetic turf will blow the natural grass right out of the way, because typically you're getting, on a lighted natural grass field, you're seeing 500 to 600 uses per year. On a well-maintained irrigated natural grass field, you want to restrict those uses to somewhere around 200 to 250 uses before you really start to see a detriment to the turf. Any questions?
On option one on field three, the track field, would that trigger the plumbing code?
Option, this option here?
Yeah.
Maintaining the existing track?
Yeah.
No.
Because you're not touching the bleachers.
Yeah.
Okay. Are you familiar with that?
Sorry.
The CPC funding, CPC, the newer legislation, has specific language when it comes to synthetic turf. They won't pay for the for the carpet,
yeah.
But you can get funding for the infrastructure,
yeah.
The base, unless it's a stadium?
Unless it, yes. The way the law is written is this project not funding stadium.
So so fields 4 and 5 and field 13 would probably be exempt from that? Or?
Yes, I think all of them, honestly. So Norwell, which I'll jump back to, used CPC funding. CPC funded this project.
Isn't that a stadium?
No, not, Norwell did not classify this as a stadium. They funded this project, both of these are right next to each other, track and field is here. But they privately fundraised for, Norwell actually took this as far as we've seen it, where they've privately fundraised for the synthetic turf product. And CPC funds paid for the installation of the product and all of the infrastructure, drainage, walkways associated with that.
Sean, did you do the bleachers there or no?
The bleachers
were there?
Remained. We did about 200 portable bleachers on the visitor side.
But the bleachers were there, like these, like at Hopkinton?
Yeah, the bleachers were existing. Another example is Concord-Carlisle used CPC funds when they converted their natural grass field at their main football game field. And they privately fundraised for the synthetic turf. Now they paid for this product and the installation of the synthetic turf.
So in your opinion, all of these could be potentially funded
yes.
through CPC funds?
Yes.
In other communities that you've done this type of work in, are they say, for example, we're not set up right now with the ticket booth or anything like that, which religious component there, so I'm just kind of thinking about the setup aspect of the game. Is that something that you're typically building in together for places that don't have it, other than putting in a complex or facility like this, or how does that work?
We can work with you to do that. Obviously, we didn't look at that specifically,
yeah.
But we've done numerous, and I actually had the slide in and then I took it out because I didn't want to mark it too much, but we have various like entryways we've designed,
okay.
Donor walls, things like that, a combination, you know, tied it into the ticket booth, you know.
Sure.
So yes,
okay.
we could assist you with, you know, identifying your central, because I know, yeah, you got the little girl at the table up above the football stadium.
We actually
shivering in her blanket.
During the schematic design phase, that's one of our bullets on our agendas, is how important is ticketed admissions and creating a crowd control
sure.
atmosphere. So at Triton here, we actually use the building where, you see, between the building, everyone is funneled between the ticket windows right at the front, and we're able to incorporate that into their entranceway statement. We would certainly, during any schematic design phase, go through that process.
Yeah, thank you.
So for option two, which was to reconfigure the track.
Right.
So you mentioned that the track itself is reaching the end of its usable life.
Okay,
so
yes.
The base.
The base.
Is,
right.
Yeah, track has, track under your regular track, and of course, that's a pretty simple track, but under your, you have like almost like regular pavement under your track would be a section of like a road pavement,
right.
And then on top of that is where they put the rubber, urethane, and there's various brands, but you know, it's usually like
half inch, so.
And then they do like the rubber spray, you know, goes in a couple layers, but that's just your top. And fortunately, you know, it's only been 4 years that you had your top, you know, you had resurfaced. But usually, what's it, 5 to 7 years on the
Typically,
resurfacing per se. What's recommended, but
I think we went a little longer than
that.
Yeah,
most
that's recommended.
So I guess what I'm getting at, so I'm trying to compare thinking about this in the long term. So
yeah.
What does it cost to completely
redo
the track?
If you're right, just to take on a track project and leave
yeah.
the grass field, and you're in the range of, depending on what you do with the D areas,
mm-hmm.
you're in the range of $800,000 to $1 million just for a track project. New fencing, new pavement, new surfacing. That number fluctuates given the price of oil. A lot of these are driven by that factor. But that's why why we noted that is if you're in the next, say, 5 years or so, you have to invest that money to install a new track. You could use that as your opportunity to expand the track and then fit a ideal width playing field inside of the track.
Yeah, or look at the other one.
Yes, yeah.
If Hopkinton wanted to do exhibition games, would they have to follow MIAA, or would they have to do like NCAA standards, and how would that affect the project?
You might take that, or you can.
For this option where you're leaving the track as is.
Any of the options, it's just I know the NCAA requirements are a little bit more stringent than.
Soccer, the 225, wouldn't fit. Inside of this old,
the option two?
Option two, no.
Yep.
You're getting, this is 210, I believe, for soccer. Ideal is 195 and 115 foot radius
mm-hmm.
for a track. You could fit 210 by 330, so you're gonna shorten the length a little bit. This would not accommodate an NCAA.
So if one other, like a refs come and do an exhibition game, it wouldn't be able to do
it? They couldn't.
And then
and
what
then
about?
That's because you're restricted, unless you know, If these fields weren't a factor, we took them into account. I mean, if they were, you know, if this field replaced this field maybe or whatever, and we could push and this softball field goes away, you know, if that was the true criteria, you know, we could make it happen. Now, obviously, your retaining wall is going to get a little higher and we got that much more fill, but I mean, it could be done, but we just didn't, you know, we kind of set some criteria and the time was trying to maintain what we had.
Yeah, I think we're just looking at the long term. So
yeah.
Also with the exhibition, then I would assume that like a field house type of bathroom facility would be more mandatory at that point?
Most likely, yeah.
And accessible parking and all that?
Accessible parking, accessible routes, meeting that plumbing code.
Okay. So this would only really address the high school needs?
Yes.
And then it would be a flat stop right there, right?
Yeah, if your goals, if you came to us and said, all right, let's start this, we want to do something here, which go through those programming goals again. What are you trying to achieve?
Mm-hmm.
As part of this study, The goals that we were trying to achieve based on feedback was focusing on the high school and making the high school size field. But yes, certainly that would be a key part of the schematic design phase.
One fixtures, that's a good size building.
It's a very good size. Triton was 2,400 square feet, ended up being like around $400 a square foot. The question becomes, where's the closest sewer tie-in? Are you doing a pump station? Is it a forced main system? You know, those items are going to start driving that price up.
You have power too. I mean, you have all the heating and ventilation.
Is it going to be a seasonal building or a full-time heated building? That's going to certainly drive up.
That's a big hole.
Based on just our layout, which, you know, you see the middle school and then there's the field and then we walk back, where would we be envisioning if you were to say that building is building on the field behind?
If
would we be taking that field away, I guess is my question. Baseball and a field there?
So to start with that, the code also requires that if you're going to install, because of the seating, it has to be within 500 feet of the seating along an accessible route. So it would take me, Kathy, you might have a better sense of use of on a football game.
Actually envision, you know, the Snapchat, I think this getting blown away and being revamped, this whole area, you know, however you create your entrance to get in around the track. That, at least that's my initial thoughts, because just again, because of your grade change and such, you're not going to have people trudging up this hill. I mean, I know you go up, but you know, the steps down from the bleachers as it is tight, you know, going up and down during the games, but you know, your concession, everything, I think you're going to be driven to, one, you're going to have your access and potential parking over this way, but I envision this whole area would just get reworked and you'd probably lose the existing concession building.
Would the current bleachers meet the accessibility requirements? The current bleachers?
Yes.
They would?
Yeah, well, you come in at grade, your press box and such, you come in at grade, and I'm pretty sure there's handicap. I think it's at the one end, there's a couple
of above grade.
And up top, yeah.
But a portable bleacher system on the visitor side would be appropriate? Or does that also have to be?
Yeah, no, that's if it's a portable bleacher system where you're using throughout the site, that would not trigger.
But it's really not going to move though, right?
It depends. So I'll go back to Norwell, because they did this. So they didn't touch their home bleachers. They didn't want to trigger the plumbing code. But you can see in the top of the screen the existing three-bay visitor bleachers, an accessible route all the way to them. They're on a concrete pad. They have the ability to pick those up and move them around the site. I don't think they have since the project's been over, but that did not trigger the plan.
You hit on the existing parking facilities that you went around, kind of the current condition. Do you have any sense of if we wanted to, are there options within that footprint for parking expansion? I know it's dicey back there.
Anything can be done, but it would have to be evaluated, because you're really limited. I mean, unless, you know, and I know a lot of this is wetlands over here, so, I mean, there's things are possible, and, you know, the permitting might be a little more difficult. But
what about back by 13?
Back by 13? Again, I think, well, you've got wetlands on this side. Back in here, I think some of this could be pushed, but I don't know if it'd be enough for, you know, what you need. I mean, I think there's maybe 40 spaces there, maybe. But unless, you know, you do one big deal, well, this is all pretty tight, and I suspect there's reasons there's not parking in here because there are environmental concerns and such, but like I said, we know of the wetlands through here, but there are various little streams through those little areas, so, but I think there's probably ability to maybe push that parking a little bit.
To definitively answer that question, we'd have to do a background investigation, look at rarely where those wetland constraints are, where those streams are. do a topographic survey so we get a sense of grade and what costs would be, do some borings to see if there's any ledge or unsuitable soils, and then we'd be able to narrow down a true spot by those fields where you could fit existing parking or proposed parking.
I know this is real high level right now, but this schedule right here, is that based upon which design?
It's one of these designs, a typical track and field project.
I mean, I would assume that if you went for option two, that would require a whole lot more work to put a new retaining wall in and all that.
It would. Typically, these projects are roughly, without any buildings involved, are a three-month design process.
Yeah. That, I mean, that's as tight as you get, though, right?
This is as tight as
you get. It's pretty tight.
Yeah.
We did a 30-foot high retaining wall up at Shawshin. We designed it from November to, I think it went to permitting at the end of December. Bid docs for February. I mean, it was massive, this wall, but we were able to.
This is what you end up doing is you permit the project concurrently as you're finishing design and bidding. Now, the risk involved with that is if there's a significant permitting order of conditions that changes the bid documents and you're out to bid, then you've got to issue an addendum or it's going to be your first change order out of construction, but you never get the full dollar. So the This is tight. What we wanted to show that if there was any vision for next year, you really got to start the process now, or you're almost getting behind the eight ball for next year construction.
And the soil conditions. So, if you were to, I know big cost nowadays is soils.
Yeah.
If you did the retaining wall project, then I would assume you'd be able to use a little bit, but because you create such a basin for the infill material or the actual fill material.
Yeah.
Get the drainage right. I mean, that's a lot of dirt.
It is a lot of dirt.
It is a lot of dirt.
You are. All of this topsoil is coming out, which can't be used as structural fill.
Right.
You're bringing in roughly 12 inches of stone base for the drainage of the synthetic turf field. But this whole triangle piece, where that slope,
it's all compacted, leveled up,
yeah. Compacted fill. You know, $25-$30 a cubic yard. It's expensive.
Yep. Is that, and that's taken into account in your 3-1?
That's it.
Yes. Yeah.
What about export?
The export we accounted, that's in there as well. We have a line strip and dispose. Now granted, a lot of the contractors work their own deals with what they do with the topsoil. And also there's an options, you know, we've had a Tantasco, which a field that I did, they took the topsoil and were able to store it somewhere. It's a lot of material, but they were able to store it, and now they have it to come and work on their grass fields to like redo them.
Yeah, I mean, if you screen it right, you can then repair the other fields.
Right, and it, you know, it helped some on the cost, but they still had to kind of take it off site, and then someone's got to bring it back. So I don't know if it was as cost, you know, savings as they hoped, but, you know, there's always that option that somewhere gets identified, you know, closer, you know, somewhere else in town or something that somebody might be able to finagle to bring that cost down a little bit. But we assume, you know, they just take
it. What we try to warn is that it's a large pile. I mean, it's 100 feet by 100 feet by 25 feet high. I mean, it's a very large pile. Narragansett, Rhode Island wanted to save it. They saved it, and within 3 months they said this is a hazard. You got kids climbing on it, the dust is blowing all over the place, we just need to get rid of it. So unless you have a very secure spot, where you can protect it and make sure kids aren't getting to it.
That's worth something though to the general contractor.
It does help their number usually, but yeah. Most of our numbers, you know, are coming right from projects we've done. We did 12 jobs this summer that, you know, we've done fields, and you know, these are current numbers, you know, talking April season. They were bid all in the spring.
We just finished an organic field, so that's about another like $200,000 on top of that.
You got to add a pad.
Yeah, and rock pad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which, regardless, I mean, when we get into a design development discussion, pad might be a good option, even if you choose not to go with an alternative infill, just a typical sand and rubber field.
Yeah, I didn't know how much you wanted to get into alternative infills, or if you had questions. We provided in the handout is a big chart, which is kind of, Gail's compiled over the years of the different infills, and I don't know if everyone understands what the infill is. So we just kind of brought an example to just kind of show you, and this is This is called, this is a coated sand. It's an Envirofill, but just to show you kind of the layers, you know, you'd have the stone base below this in the field. This is what we call a shock pad, which with alternative infills, they, you have to have the shock pad. That gets back to your impact issues, you know, concussions, that sort of thing. The crumb rubber fields, they can meet the what they call the GMAX criteria without the shock pad. The alternative infills do not, so they put in the shock pad. And then this is, you know, this part, the grass, is what we call the carpet. And then obviously the stuff in between is your infill. And I don't want to, if people know whatever, I know some people have been through this before, but sometimes the pictures, you know, it helps you see.
Is the life of the shock pad equal to the carpet?
No, the shock pad are supposed to last as long as the field, 25 years.
And the shock pad is the 130K that you have in here?
It ranges. There's various ones. This one is a Brock pad, which is probably one of the best ones going, which is a little more expensive. But they have different ones. Again, this is the Brock pad, but then you have, this one is like a little more flimsy. I think this is the Schmidt.
No, that's actually Brock as well. That's,
oh, this is Brock too? Yeah, okay, sorry. Because it looks similar to the one I did out at Tantas.
In the public market, I know Brock is working with the Attorney General's office, but they own the patent on polypropylene. And they're the only ones in the United States that can sell a polypropylene pad. So when you're putting together specifications, we can't put together a proprietary spec. More than three people have to meet that. So I know they're working with the Attorney General, but in a public bid scenario, it's very difficult. Our experience has been that it's difficult to spec a Brock pad, the top line Brock pad, and get that Brock pad.
Right. So you can't spec a proprietary item, but when we bid it, can we make that a proprietary item?
The bid laws, you can, if you want to write a spec that only one product can meet, the law requires you to write a paragraph or write an article stating why you think this is in the best interest of the town or the school.
So similar in other municipal building projects, requirements for profit.
Yeah, and then if it were, you have to put that in the file, and if it were protested later, you have to have that record, pull that record, and say this is why we did it, and then everyone, you'd have to review that, go through that process, and it could be, someone could fight that determination. Most of the time, the Attorney General's office will side with the owner, if it's with good reason. So
what are you proposing for the field, though? Because field hockey wants to be fast, soccer a little bit slower, football slowest, right?
We, to be honest with you, we haven't gotten into those discussions yet.
I'm just saying, like, you know, because it's all that split film type of fun stuff, but field hockey really seems to be most stringent of a...
Most of the schools that we've done that are multi-purpose is split.
It's a hybrid.
It's a hybrid, about 2 inches, 2 to 2.5 inches, and it's the hybrid and.
It's a combination of slit and monofilament.
Yeah.
Right.
So it seems to be the best for as many sports as it can be. That's what they.
But it's not ideal for one sport.
It's not.
No.
You know, so if you came to us and said, we're going to play 100% soccer on this field, for example, we would come back and say, all right, well, monofilament, blades of the fiber are going to stand up a little bit longer, and that's the type of surfacing you want. If you're going to play strictly football on this, slip film is more ideal for football. Where you have a multi-use or multi-sport field, then we can start getting into conversations, all right, which sport is the dominant sport? What are you going to use more? And then we can start narrowing that down. If it's truly strictly all different various uses, evenly distributed, then we're getting into discussions about hybrids or you know, straight monofilament.
But what I found is that it's really, no one's really happy.
No.
If you do a hybrid. So field hockey won't be happy, and you know, soccer won't be happy. It's just, but everyone will be happy to have a new field.
And then if you were to do this option where you're in the baseball field and softball field, then you're in a whole other discussion because you want to show a little shorter pile height in the infields to let it play a little faster. You want to increase your sand content again to make it a little faster. So there's a number of combinations you can do with the fields. But that really, when we go through a programming discussion,
in any design process, we always have the opportunity, we could walk existing fields to get a feel for it. We go through that type of process. Yeah, no one comes out as a true winner except for everybody that gets to play on it.
Especially when they first open it, which is nice.
Yeah.
Just a question, you guys may have already mentioned some of this. So in option two, when we are widening the track, we obviously need to put that restroom building facility in to make that happen. If we went with option one, which is just turfing the existing field, and we're lucky enough to look at potentially doing 4 and 5 as well, would we also need to put a new restroom facility in?
No, because you don't have bleachers. If you're not putting permanent bleachers, that's what kicks you into the plumbing code.
So would this is like one, oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, you've kind of estimated a structure of like a 1.1 million or whatever that was. If you were to want to put something in, that would be like an entrance with a concession or something like that. Is that a general estimate as of a 1.1 million or is that like?
No, I mean, we're seeing it's roughly $400 a square foot is a good number without knowing a lot of your program. What's your building finish is going to look like? Are you doing brick facade? Is it CMU block construction or wood construction? There's a number of variables in there.
The other thing, a lot of these buildings have storage. They have some bathrooms. They have changing rooms for the referees. So, you know, you can go bare minimum and just be restrooms.
Yep.
And then obviously the restrooms are the more expensive part of the building. The fixtures, your plumbing is the most costly. But obviously it wouldn't be as much as a building that has, you know, concession, well, you know, if you do concession, you know, you can do cheap concession without, you know, stoves and, you know, things along those lines as well. And those are things we evaluate with you. But
if you were to look at this type of scenario on all the fields you've looked at, I mean, if you did the football field over and just made it purely football, you'd probably do a certain grass type. And then would you say there's $3 or $4 million? Do you see an option like where you threw out some stuff on with the last fields? Then you could do something like that, which you say is 3-3, but you could do one of the fields, or you would probably want to do both of the fields and have them more single sport oriented.
Yeah, I mean, you can.
But you don't require bleachers here, right, for soccer or for field
hockey? No, I mean, that's getting really into the programming discussion of what sport do you want to play here? And how many spectators are attending those games, and how many bleachers do you want? Then we get into the type of surfacing you want. But certainly all of these options, I mean, we can talk about just doing this field synthetic with the football field synthetic or...
But if you left the football field within this track area forget every other sport, being that just football, that's the smallest footprint?
160,
Or it's one of the...
But you probably would still take the turf all the way to the track. I mean, you wouldn't do less turf.
Right, but you're... The larger dimensions are really more geared towards the other sports and where you need more. I mean, the runoff, you don't have a ton here, but I guess you do if you have the...
The feedback we get is, and the reason why a lot of schools, unless they're truly landlocked or they have no other option, that most of them will not go ahead and put synthetic turf inside this oval because you're not getting the best bang for your buck.
Yeah.
And they would rather spend it creating a footprint that can accommodate all sports.
So you're saying for soccer and women's lacrosse, this is not ideal. Does that mean that you cannot play a game on it, or it's just you wouldn't play a playoff game on it?
No, I mean, you can certainly play both. It's recognized by the MIAA. The minimum dimensions are still met. So you can have an MIAA event on that field.
Okay.
You're going to meet the minimum dimensions of this, say, women's lacrosse or soccer.
Okay.
You're not playing at the ideal, what they want to play.
Right. But for the usage that we have right now, who would lose anything by doing this option?
No. This would continue exactly what you have today, just a surface that is changing from natural grass to synthetic.
Okay. And then my second question is, assuming we don't make permanent visitor bleachers, so we don't have to put in bathrooms, we still could put in a building, right, that would be concessions and tickets and...
That would be up to you. There's nothing that really dictates that.
So the only thing that triggers the requirement for the plumbing is the permanency of the visitor bleachers, not anything. So every other option is open to us.
Well, but my opinion is as well, and it would be a conversation with the local building inspector, if you were going to install a building with one fixture in it, I feel as though you would have to meet the fixture count for what the existing seating is. Once you introduce one, you have to meet the code for the site. So you have an 800 person bleacher system, and then if you would have to meet that, even if you didn't install bleachers elsewhere, but you just built a building.
If we renovated the existing building, which has sinks but no toilets?
If you're not adding fixtures or bathrooms, then I think you can renovate that without having to meet the code.
Would you estimate in option one replacing the lighting?
Lighting is
in option one. You just relocating the lighting. I think we did.
No, in option one. You include
just
in
replace
option.
It.
Yeah.
Roughly 400 to 500,000, depending on power.
And about 800,000 for an track.
About 800. Yeah, roughly, depending on what you do with the areas. I'll have three lighting numbers on Thursday. I've got a 8-pole lighting system bid on Thursday that will give me a good sense of where they're coming in these days.
And like Musco a lot.
Yeah. Musco has 95% of the market share around here. They're almost coming out with their LED technology, which we're told is fantastic. But we bid it out as an alternate last year in Norwood, and the pricing was still $150,000 to $200,000 more. So the technology's quite out there.
Regards to other communities that you guys have worked with, how many have turf fields inside the track like ours with those dimensions? I know you said they're not ideal.
Yeah.
And obviously there's a safety issue we started to talk about.
Right.
Obviously the cost is the most appealing for this issue.
Right.
Shrewsbury
is where they're not building it yet, but they're going for it. It's the same exact track, and that's what they're doing. They just kind of pushed the envelope as far as they can within the existing track.
I would say the majority of them, if they have the ability to and the money, they will push. But we always have schools that say we can't, we don't have the space, we don't have the funds, but we want a synthetic turf field. This is what we're going to do.
Oh, Tantasco, we did that.
Yeah, Tantasco as well.
It's like it's looking like soccer. What's the yellow line? Soccer.
Yellow soccer, yeah. And then the blue is your women's lacrosse.
The sports that are really hurt,
yeah,
like soccer and women's lacrosse.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So, like for example, soccer is up to the track. You're not even looking at the runoff
and stuff
like that.
I think you've got about. I don't know what we have for soccer. We're saying like 195 is ideal, and you have 208, so that gives you about 5 feet on each side. You'd hit the track pretty.
Yeah.
They do. I mean, the games.
That's good because lacrosse is defensive,
I know.
Yeah,
not 10.
If you wait for the next fiscal year, I mean, you're talking 3 to 5% escalation.
Yeah. I mean, it really vary depending on interest rates and how those are moving, but. I think inflation these days is just under 2%.
What's the preferred carpet for field hockey?
Well, the preferred carpet is
the weed, right?
Yeah, it's a knitted nylon carpet.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And you're paying $7 a square foot compared to $4 a square foot. And it's a carpet that none of the other sports want to play on.
Thinks fast.
Yeah.
You're putting it on. You're actually putting it on.
So in the real world, what would be?
The real world is you want to get a short pile height and you want a hard, firm surface.
So the slip film or minor film?
Ideally, I think you'd want to go with probably a slip film where the slip film rolls over, you have tremendous ball speed. In a hard, I'll call firm infill material. So a little bit more sand content, a little bit less rubber content if you're sticking with strictly a sand rubber field.
So football and field hockey would be close?
Yeah, close. Football, a little bit longer pile height for football. But yeah, both on the slip film. Where soccer is monofilament, where those fibers are standing up and the ball is playing on the top of the fibers.